Good afternoon, colleagues, and welcome to this session on how to make IP work better for development in the era of innovation and creativity. This session is an interest one and very unique to the discussions that we've had in the TDS, and it stands out. And so it promises to be an interesting conversation. Now, my name is there, obviously. I'm senior fellow at ICTSD, the organizers of this TDS event. But I know my colleagues from my past. Maricela was under the committee, the copyright committee of WIPO, as a delegate, and I used to chair it. So we were negotiating the Marrakesh Treaty on Visually Impaired, whatever it's called now. may I introduce the panelists for today? On my immediate right is Sachin Chaturvedi, Director General at the Research and Information Systems for Developing Countries. Sachin, welcome. And on my far left is Esteban Donoso, President of the Board of Pro Humano Henere and Partner Corporation Legal, EC. Welcome, Esteban. It's a pleasure having you here, and we look forward to your presentation. Maricela, who I've already introduced, is an IP expert and a former executive director of the Kenya Copyright Board. And then I have Padmashri Sampath, Chief Technology and Innovation Report Series, UNCTAD, and Research Fellow, United Nations University. Welcome, Padmashri. I will start by calling on Sachin Chaturvedi to share his initial remarks for 10 minutes, and then we can move to the next speaker and so forth before we engage with our esteemed audience. Sachin, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At outset, would like to thank ICTSD for this partnership and this opportunity for discussing issues related to this extremely important dimension of the treaty that all of us are discussing as part of WTO mechanism. This morning we launched a major report from our institute, RIS, and those of you who are not aware, RIS is a policy research institute with Indian Ministry of External Affairs. It's dedicated to work on South-South cooperation. So though we are based in India, but our perspective and our research focus is on the larger South. So this report that we launched this morning, those of you who are interested, we have still few copies left with us. In this report, there is one chapter on intellectual property rights, where we have tried to capture how the unfolding of our TRIPS regime and the nuances of this regime has favored few, and the exclusions are too many. So from that point of view, how the royalty payments and their flows have emerged in last 10 years, how United States inflows in their revenue metrics multiplied from $1 billion in 2005 to $10.23 billion by 2014 is something that this report talks about. So there are several issues that are of key significance when we talk of intellectual property rights, and this has a larger canvas. In this report, we have also tried to analyze how the mega regionals, which are coming up, and the way TRIPS regime is being set aside. Those of us who have been associated with the initiatives right from Cancun days, and I had the opportunity of partnering with ICTSD in Cancun to have a side event on intellectual property rights, and we had said that TRIPS is true intrusive. It is compromising the policy space that developing countries have, but TPP is a major sweep. It's complete compromise on the kind of calibrated industrial policy that developing countries should have. So from that perspective, I would have a few slides that I would like to discuss, and would also like to bring your attention on the larger canvas that we think is important for contextualizing the debate on intellectual property rights. The idea is more in terms of bringing forward the role that we think is extremely important. Both WIPO and couple of other institutions, including ICTSD, have done immensely well in terms of capturing the idea in terms of how the issues are going to be affected. And the point is in terms of how the six major technologies, airplane technology, the antibiotics, the semiconductors, the 3D printing, nanotechnology, and robotics, how they show a sort of concentration across high-income countries. And these exclusions are happening at a cost when the policy space for developing countries is very little. We see that there is a counter trend which is emerging in terms of how academic institutions are playing an important role in terms of getting the patents. And from that point of view, it's also important to realize where maximum concentration of patents are happening, where actually the intellectual property is being protected. So from that point of view, we have tried to see how Article 7 and 8, which couldn't focus on the implementation part, have also helped in a way in strengthening the IP regime, and of course in terms of leading to issues that have questioned the way industrial policy or technology policy across the country. Idea of technology transfer, I'm very sorry to say, hasn't moved much. There are still several initiatives, but what happened with Africa in case of AIDS crisis, we know pretty well. After a lot of negotiations, after the launch of Doha Round, the amendment that was adopted could help us export generics, but there are still norms which are adversely affecting this whole question of access to technology. There are concerns. 2004 to 7, we were extremely concerned about TRIPS plus regime, but as I'm saying, TRIPS plus, we are going with TPP, and that way a major issue is in terms of how we look at these RTAs and their implication on the global TRIPS regime. The issues which are related to capacity building, the way countries, the laggards in the technology race, what scope for them to catch up? And this catching up process is completely squeezed off from the process if we go ahead with this plus regime. And that's where the question is in terms of what kind of policy space we have. India launched a major initiative for access to medicine through what was called as Open Source Drug Discovery Project, OSDD. And this project has tried to strengthen linkages across private firms, the public institutions, and some funding that is possible through the public sector-led initiatives. And they have tried to at least address issues related to tuberculosis, TB-related drugs, and also a couple of other vaccine development joint programs which have been launched as part of that. The options like patent pool, clearing houses, pre-competitive collaboration, and using different licensing patterns, that can be facilitated. So if we want to be constructive on the debate, and TRIPS, there are certain policy options which developing countries and their national governments should think of. And there I would really urge ICTSD to play an important role in terms of impressing upon national governments to explore some of these options as their policy choices. Whatever happens tomorrow here at WTO would have marginal impact in terms of new IP regime that we are going to face from the mega regionals. WTO somehow has got itself squeezed to margins only when it comes to global regime. It has become extremely clear now. On this TRIPS, the national governments would have to act, and that's why we thought this panel would play an important role in terms of passing on this message. The third point is about strengthening public sector R&D, and that's where several African countries and some of the other in the Latin American region would have to see where the national interest lies. And there, again, the South-South cooperation way forward as would be a sort of instrument that countries would have to explore. And there, I think idea is also to see how innovation can be leveraged for the larger development challenges. The adoption of sustainable development goals and the issues that are related to access to technology. We saw what happened at the climate change debate in Paris in terms of access to technology. There are monetary arrangements made. I think time has come to leverage them for collective gain. I would like to mention particularly the proposal that Brazil and India and of course other countries supported in terms of technology facilitation mechanism, TFM. The question is how to operationalize TFM and how countries would be able to share technologies or private firms would be able to share technologies for getting adequate royalty payments to them. In India, we are hosting a major conference in March to discuss how this TFM-related contours can be explored further for moving ahead with SDG, but also trying to leverage the industrial policy-related issues that are of key significance. With these points, I would like to stop here, but definitely would like to urge ICTSD and other international organizations to explore possibility of connecting national governments with this larger debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sachin. Esteban, you have been involved in research around TRIPS, and therefore the issues that Sachin raises are not new to you. Could you add some thoughts to this subject matter?
Thank you. Thank you, Darlington. Can I get the slide too? Thank you. Well, I want to tell you about this new proposal I have been researching. And it's called the Trip Plus Ultra. So somebody will see this as something wrong, but let me explain why it's called Trip Plus Ultra and what it represents. So by going word by word, we will understand it better. So first, TRIPS, you know, the TRIPS is the World Trade Organization Agreement on Intellectual Property that was established more than 20 years ago, and we want to change this agreement in its Article 33 in order to implement an equitable burden-sharing system for patents, in which each country contributes in accordance to its wealth to promote new technology. It's as easy as that. If implemented, the current system could afford many other changes, maybe, and hopefully. Before this, before the Trip Plus Ultra, no proposal stands a chance, in my point of view. No proposal to change the TRIP has stood a chance for more than 20 years now. TRIP is here to stay, and this has to be recognized with political pragmatism. Plus means more in Latin and in many other languages. Plus, sorry. It's also described when used together with the acronym TRIPS, as in TRIP Plus, to refer to the international push for more and a stronger protection of intellectual property. TRIP Plus is a name given by the academia in Europe and the United States initially to denounce this push. The bad guys in this narrative are their governments, the US and Europe, because the US and Europe tend to create more and stronger intellectual property within their borders, especially the US, because they truly believe this is the path for global development, especially the US. Due to the strong leadership of the US and Europe, little by little, free trade agreement by free trade agreement, the law of the land in most countries is becoming 3+. But 3+ is not welcomed by the developing world. Neither 3 nor 3+ distributes the weight of the burden of innovation. The answer may be as simple as to change that. Ultra, finally, means beyond in Latin. Trip plus ultra will basically reset the trips and make it a more just and effective model. As we will see, it will go beyond. This equitable burden sharing system will change everything. You have a chart in your hands, or it's around, I hope, and you will see it. There's a long list there. All countries in the world are mentioned in it. Each country has a different pattern length, which changes year by year. This is the big change that will reset the system. Proportionality in the contribution that we as a whole give to innovators, regardless their nationality, is the pragmatic answer for TRIPS. TRIP plus ultra is convenient for both sides, poor countries and rich countries, and the ones in between alike. That is the beauty of this, and the benefits will be felt in the short term. TRIP plus ultra will liberate the burden for the poorest and in a drastic way. This is just. The system will also yield more profit for innovation, and especially it will be produced in a more efficient way. TRIP plus ultra is convenient for both sides, and it will be convenient as soon as it is implemented. To implement TRIP plus ultra, I have designed a formula, which is by no means the only way to get to a similar result. In it, the years by country are going to change, but the current global reward towards innovation is not gonna move. This formula yields the chart I hope you have in your hands. So let's talk about the innovators. Let's take the Indian and Europe patent to explain it by an example. Any innovator, if they register their patents in both places, they will have the same potential reward regardless if they are from India, Europe, or even anywhere else due to the non-discrimination policy of the World Trade Organization. The economic return produced by additional years in the countries that will give more than 20 years, according to the chart, roughly the 21st seven countries in the list, which are the richest countries in the world, will more than cover for India having only 7-year patents instead of 20-year patents. India is a huge market, and it will certainly hurt innovator to lose that revenue. Sure, but it will be compensated. Countries like Botswana will have to give 14 years, which is more than many other developing countries. For example, Ecuador, my country, with 11 years. It is because Botswana is in a better condition than Ecuador. That is solidarity. That is equity. China is an amazing case. Seeing the chart how its contribution grows from 7 years to 13 years in only a decade. This is because China has developed, and it's good for all, for China especially. Everybody looks like a winner in this situation. Are there any losers in this proposal? Well, of course, yes, there are. The poor in the United States, for instance. Their government is better equipped, though, than many poor countries to help their own. Many developed countries have solid social security systems that could certainly take the blow. TRIP plus ultra proposal will reset the system. That is why I say it will go beyond. Arguments that are now identified with one side will flip to the other. For instance, too strong a protection will cease to be commercially convenient per se on its own for the United States, Japan, Europe, and other developed countries, as it is now. This will change everything. If TRIP plus ultra gets to be implemented, it will be easier to have a real talk. Another example. In the developing world, there is poverty, but there's also creativity. Yet, although there is creativity, companies or persons in the developing world, don't file many patents. I just yesterday meet a Kenyan innovator who has a marvelous new idea. Maybe not worth of a patent protection in some countries, though. In this, if the system become trip plus ultra, poor countries could push for global protection of utility models or petite patents as full patents. It is the kind of innovation that is more easily produced in the developing world. Imagine a world which, in which a student from the University of Nairobi has a new idea, goes to its national office, and automatically gets a worldwide patent that then she could enforce in all markets in the world. Imagine a cheap, harmonized worldwide system. Imagine the global patent, maybe with 3 plus ultra. Let me give yet another example of how arguments will change. I have hopes that if the proposal is implemented, we could constrain the use of compulsory licensing in some countries, and by doing so, provide at least some relief for orphan diseases. This is a revolutionary idea for developing countries in itself. The promise of a reward in big markets like Brazil, Mexico, and China could do the trick for tropical diseases, for instance. Only by resetting the system, this could be plausible. Additionally, I have theorized about other advantages of my proposal. Among them, technology transfers could actually be enhanced because companies of the developed world would like to go to the developing world to copy their competition in that market only. I don't have, sadly, the time now to explain other issues that I have addressed in my publications, nor I have the time to explain how I got to the conclusion that the economic conclusion that the system will be more efficient. It has to do with dead weight loss reduction that is proven with the modest chart used as a cover of your materials and now that is shown here. You could read about it in my article at JPL in Journal of Intellectual Property at NYU. The chart that you have in your hands, that which lists country by country, the one I hope you have got to know now and love now, comes from the same paper as well. Please check my publications and this proposal, and please support us. Thank you very much. Asante.
Thank you very much, Esteban. We look forward to reading the detail of your research, and I hope it won't just end on being a research. The proposal can be developed through the negotiation process of the WTO. Maricela, how do we integrate developing countries into the global IP system, and how can we make IP work for development? You have the floor.
Thank you very much, Darlington. Good afternoon, everyone. For me, I think I have a PowerPoint presentation, but I'll just skip it, so we can just have a chat. What I was looking at today morning, I had a very interesting read. There's someone who had written an article about the role of IP in development, and basically their argument was that IP does not help development in developing countries. And he said that it was more to do with governance issues. But I think we need to look beyond, you know, IP is one of the instruments that we need to use if we are to develop in the country. And my focus today is basically going to be on copyright and related rights, and more specifically on issues of access to knowledge. Does copyright impede or facilitate copyright and related rights? I mean, access to knowledge. And I was thinking, we're talking about TRIPS 20 years down the line. What is it that has happened in developing countries that has changed? Because basically prior to, I think, the TRIPS agreement, for most of the developing countries, the copyright landscape was more to be akin to the world, you know, the Wild West. We had copyright laws, but they had not been updated over the years and everything. The copyright industries were basically struggling. And I can think, you can see a marked difference between, probably if you go back to 1995, you look at the film industry, especially in West Africa, Burkina Faso, Nigeria, Ghana has grown. You look at the music industry, it has grown. But the question is, when we are talking about knowledge, if you are talking about education, how has copyright, how can we use, because I mean TRIPS is already there. We've heard about the TRIPS Plus and TRIPS Ultra Plus. What can we do with the existing provisions in the TRIPS agreement to see how best we can actually nurture the creative industries in the developing countries. And I think many countries have looked into that, and probably I'll just give you a brief synopsis. When you're looking at the copyright landscape, you're basically looking at the issue of the legal framework. Then you look at the management of the copyright industries and all those other issues, and then finally enforcement. And I think when we were dealing with the TRIPS agreement, the main issue that came out was enforcement, because the others were already there, you know, and it laid out very specific of provisions in relation to enforcement of, especially when you're talking about copyright and related rights. So you find that if you have a good, a strong copyright system, there are certain issues that you need to have for you to be able to facilitate access to knowledge. And one of those is basically the flexibilities that are offered under the copyright regime. And the interesting thing is that you find that most of the developing countries do not maximize on the existing flexibilities. So we focus so much on the rights that are granted, and we look at them from a negative perspective, but we do not know how to turn that around to our advantage. And I think that's one of the things that if we look critically at the TRIPS agreement, the Berne Convention in relation to copyright, and we look critically at our national laws, we'll see that there are certain things that we haven't looked into, and we need to address them. For instance, we've been dealing a lot with exceptions and limitations, and I know for the most of the South American countries, their exceptions and limitations are very narrowly construed. So it makes it very difficult, you know, like for instance, for you to do anything outside the copyright law within the exceptions and limitations or within the licensing regimes. And it's important that we actually look into those laws. And it applies to most of the African countries because we also have the same issue. If you look at the exceptions and limitations in the Kenyan law, they are so narrowly construed. As a university professor, you cannot create course packs. And this is something that you find is allowed in the United States. It's allowed in the UK and other developed countries. So you find these are some of the things that we need to take advantage of. We need to look into our copyright laws and rework those exceptions and limitations within the context of the TRIPS agreement. Of course, we have the three-step test, which is very controversial, but still, it gives you some guiding principles as to what you need to do. And I think that's one area that we need to look into. And also the issues of the other flexibilities, the duration. We've seen people going beyond TRIPS. TRIPS basically gives 50 years. Then you have Ghana, which has 70 years. You have Jamaica, which has 100 years. Why would you be protecting copyright for that long? Because one of the things we need to know is that creativity builds upon creativity. So for us to be able to create this knowledge, and I think there's also this issue of everybody looking at developing countries as net consumers of knowledge. People have totally forgotten that we create, you know. You have a lot of south-to-south movement of knowledge. How do you protect this knowledge? How do you deal with these issues? How do we maximize on the existing copyright system? We have the Creative Commons that has come up. It is based on the copyright system. You know, you basically cannot say your work is on Creative Commons if it's not protected by copyright in the first place. But it gives you the leeway. These are some of the things that we need to look into, more so in the digital environment. And I think with that, that's basically just my brief intro into this particular issue. And I was just to add on to the issues, I mean, there are certain issues we're looking at in terms of the regional integration, when you're looking at all these trade agreements that we are working on beyond TRIPS. We also need to look into what our regional organizations are working on. So for instance, if I was to look at COMESA, first and foremost, what's their policy in relation to intellectual property? How are we integrating it into the trade system? So are we looking at knowledge as something completely different, or are we looking at knowledge as something that we can actually trade in within our trade system? So I think these are some of the things that we need to look into. We need to look into the issues of management of copyright. We don't have strong copyright institutions, or we do not have institutions that can actually guide people. You come to Kenya, you find most of these creative authors, especially in when they're talking about digital works, the mobile telephony, the Android system, you know, all these applications that are coming up. How are they taking advantage of the copyright system? Again, the article I was reading today, the person was proposing that you really don't need a copyright system to do that. But I, on the other hand, think that you can actually monetize your creative work if you have a good copyright system in place, which has both provision for the protection as well as very good, well thought out exceptions and limitations and a good consideration of the public interest. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maricela. Don't give up the mic yet. I've got a question for you. Because you're dealing with the development aspects of IP. The question I have is relating to the moratorium that has been extended to LDCs over and over. If IP is working for development, why would you want to be extending your moratorium?
I think for most countries, as I said, when it comes to the IP laws, we haven't had proper systems in place. So you find that the laws that we have are pretty old. You know, like for instance, if I take, again, sorry to use the example of Kenya, for a very long time, our laws were based on the 1956 UK Act. Now that's the copyright law. So you find that there are certain things that have moved. Time has moved and we haven't had time to look into it. And I think one of the areas, when we had the last ministerial conference, the African ministerial conference that was held by the World Intellectual Property Organization, the most interesting thing to note is, first and foremost, the attendance at the meeting. Most people either sent the deputy ministers or, sorry to use the term, random characters from government. They did not take it seriously. And you find that the countries which did take it seriously, they actually are not going to go hustling for the extension because they're actually using the IP system to make it work. So I think Esteban had said, there are issues to do with policy, you know. What does the government, do we have any policies that deal with IP and development? What are our strategies? You know, like for instance, if I'm to look at most of the developing countries, IP is something that just flows. It's something that we literally, it's held, it's something that happens. It's not something that is inbuilt within our systems. So I think for the LDCs, instead of, like for instance, if you're dealing with issues of copyright, seeking to extend the moratorium, they should actually start looking for ways to maximize on the existing IP system. There are those who will argue, okay, fine. China joined the WTO much later. Meanwhile, they had already built their knowledge systems and stuff like that. The US, by the time it was joining Bern, it had already established itself. So there are those who will argue that, yes, for in terms of you to create knowledge, you'll be able to, you have to have that particular period of time for you to create. But that can only work if you're actually creating the knowledge and doing something about it. But if you're sitting down and having this attitude of we are waiting for people to do this for us. No matter how long the moratorium is extended, we're not going to grow our industry because we continue being net consumers of knowledge. So we are not concentrating on creating the knowledge, because if you're creating the knowledge, chances are you'd want to protect it. But if you're always getting it from somewhere else, you'd want to get it as much of it as possible with the minimum restrictions. Yeah.
Thank you. Padmashri, you have been engaged in research for a long time, research on innovation and development. You're welcome, and shall we have your views on this subject matter?
Thanks a lot, Darlington. And actually, I need that clicker. Do you think I can use it from here? How do I move to my presentation? So, first of all, I'd like to thank ICTSD and RIS for inviting me on this highly interesting panel. And I think that the discussion neatly fits into what I'm going to talk about, which is the question of how least developed countries can actually advance their innovation needs to try and move towards a greater win-win within the context of the TRIPS agreement, especially within the context of the TRIPS moratorium. Okay, this presentation that I'm going to give today is based on joint work that I am doing along with a very old friend and dear colleague, Pedro Roffe of the ICTSD. We've also published a preliminary note on this, which I think was published by ICTSD and which is available, and I can make it available to anybody who's interested. But it also draws on a lot of other work that I have been doing at UNCTAD or with other people. Now, just to sort of like give a background, yesterday we launched actually a flagship report of UNCTAD called the Technology and Innovation Report that I'm the team leader of, and it deals with the same question. And the question is basically, the opening point is if you take the high-tech exports worldwide today, African countries only account for 0.3% of all high-tech exports as of 2014. And that, if you take that as the background, one really needs to start thinking about how TRIPS, as an agreement on innovation within the WTO impacts on least developed countries and how it can be used by least developed countries. That's actually the opening point of our work. This keeps going. Okay. Now, least developed countries are treated as a special case in the context of the TRIPS agreement. The preamble recognizes their special needs in terms of maximum flexibility. You have special transitional arrangements and the need for flexibility to create a viable technological base in the TRIPS agreement. You have existing waivers until 2021. And you also have the special case of pharmaceuticals and health, where you have a waiver now until 2013. You also see commitments in the TRIPS agreement to promote and encourage technology transfer under Article 66, Clause 2, and you have specific technical cooperation commitments under Article 67. Now, the emphasis of existing approaches, if you conduct a review, you see that the formal emphasis in technical cooperation initiatives has been on how to ensure the convergence of LDC legislations on IPRs with that of the TRIPS agreement, instead of trying to see how to benefit from greater flexibilities and the implementation of these flexibilities in the policy space of LDCs. You also see, actually, that the recent discussion on the latest extension waiver, that there is a lack of integration of real information on LDC ground realities, and a big conceptual gap amongst main actors. So what you see, for instance, is that LDCs insisted on an open-ended waiver until countries technologically and industrially upgrade, and you see other views advocating a gradual and time-limited adherence to TRIPS obligation, but what you don't see is a systematic assessment of what is the ground reality of innovation in LDC environments and how actually the convergence of LDCs into the TRIPS agreement could be actually more of a win-win for them to have the space to technologically upgrade in the meanwhile. This always goes backwards. You also, if you review the technological linkages and collaborations, what you see is the emphasis is on scientific as opposed to technological collaboration. And this is very clear in the debate on Article 66.2 implementation in the TRIPS Council. There are also a lot of studies, actually, which have been conducted on this. And this is a very important distinction, because technological collaboration results in improving your capacity to innovate at the firm and enterprise level. Scientific collaboration might not do so, because it's about joint research, PhD training, R&D training, and so on, which is relevant, but it only helps towards building some sort of a knowledge base that needs to be further developed for technological innovation. You also see that basically the discussion keeps coming back to how to promote technological capabilities, because the issue in making technology transfer work for LDCs is not that just one of making access to technologies happen. It's one of increasing the technology absorption capacity of countries to use and adapt and innovate using those technologies. So basically what we propose is that we should actually consider the provision of TRIPS dealing with the special needs of LDCs within the concept of creating what is a sound and viable technological base. This is an interesting concept which really needs to be developed in order to earnestly address the technological gaps of LDCs. And this is a concept which actually is available in the TRIPS agreement, the need for countries to develop a sound and viable technological base. So in our work, what we are proposing is the development of a series of indicators related to how countries can develop a sound and viable technological base, taking into account the innovation gaps of least developed countries. And this we propose as a way that LDCs can advance their own innovation needs within the TRIPS agreement. And if you have convergence in this sense, it could also lead to a win-win arrangement in the medium or long term. Now, the conceptual considerations for us is basically to see technological, IP doesn't operate in vacuum. IP operates within the technological context of a country, which is why you see the argument that IP is development related and context related. So our conceptual consideration is you need to connect IP protection to the level of institutional and technology related intellectual aspects of a country. So different levels of innovation capacities depend on the general level of the country and what is available in terms of the knowledge base of that country. So any IPR regime has a varying relevance for country at a different stage of development. And even if you take a least developed country, you might have some IPRs which are useful for it, but not all of them. And therefore, you need to construct a framework on what constitutes a sound and viable technological base, and you need to have this kind of more nuanced capability building approach. So basically, we want to propose this more nuanced approach, bearing in mind the 2021 TRIPS waiver. Now, this... Yes, okay. I'm so sorry that this matrix is not very big. So I will try to go closer to explain this. Sorry. Now, what we try to do here is to look at capabilities from an innovation perspective. Okay. So if you break up capabilities of countries from an innovation perspective, what you see, how do countries learn? How do sectors learn? And how do firms learn within countries? They start from very simple, routine, experience-based capabilities. They move on to adaptive, which are more search-based capabilities for incremental innovation. And then they move on to more incremental innovation with significant novelty, like you saw in the Indian pharmaceutical sector, for instance, and then you go to state-of-the-art R&D-based innovation. Okay, and this basically denotes an increasing degree of complexity and an increasing degree of technological capabilities within the country. To move down this line, you need better physical infrastructure, you need better knowledge infrastructure in terms of skills, tertiary education, you need R&D investments, you need very good public research infrastructure, and you need a well-functioning innovation system. Now, what are the kinds of IPRs that are available? You see copyrights, creative industries, petty patents, industrial designs, trade secrets, and patents. You can actually broaden this, introduce a lot of other subcategories. But here we just try to make it very schematic and simple. So what we propose is that even if you're an LDC today, if you have creative industry, you can benefit probably from the copyright and creative industry and use that within the TRIPS agreement to leverage it. Because that's the problem you see, for instance, in the case of a lot of traditional knowledge. If you don't do something to appropriate it, someone else might appropriate it. So you need to benefit from that. But at the same time, you might not be able to benefit from the rest of it unless your level of capability is greater. And so one needs to really see, calibrate, and then strategically use the TRIPS agreement, break it down into subcomponents, and then apply it within LDC context. In our paper, what we've done is we've provided a sort of list of indicators which could be integrated for countries to assess and analyze at which stage they are of capabilities and how they could use the TRIPS for their advantage. And this is a very important sort of evidence-based approach to policy, which we are suggesting in the meanwhile, because countries need to be very cognizant. They need to prioritize the importance of IP, even if they have a waiver, because the waiver might come to an end quite fast. Time goes really fast. I was working in Bangladesh, I think in 2004, 2005, 2008, we were discussing about how to strengthen the pharmaceutical sector for the 2016 waiver. And now we are still talking about the same thing. The waiver's been extended, but a sector doesn't technologically upgrade within a year or two. It takes 10, 20 years to upgrade. And I think this kind of evidence-based approach is very important. And basically, this is what I already said. in our framework, there are indicators that exist and can be used to assess where countries are in the learning ladder. And these can be used actually to really try and calibrate the TRIPS agreement. So I'm very happy and available to answer questions on this. Thank you very much.
I have always had issues with certain special and differential provisions that were given to LDCs. It was before my time, so I'm not responsible for them. Because, for instance, I mean, how do you benefit from a legal regime if you are extending to be outside it? You have to be inside that regime in order to implement it so that you can take benefit of it. But what the LDC group has been doing is to ask for its extension to be outside that regime, and it doesn't help. And that also applies to, if I may digress a little, to the services negotiations, the modalities that took the LDCs off the table. They are not taking commitments, and therefore there is no appetite to do regulatory reform that will attract investment in services. So it works against the LDCs. But that's what we found at the WTO before my time. Now let's have discussion from the audience contributions. If you may, please introduce yourself. Make your contribution crisp and short, please. Thank you. Wei?
I'm Wei from Van Palambelis, and my first question goes to Esteban. You mentioned it's very interesting proposal, the proportionality. But my question is, what are the indicators and the methodology? How do you determine the proportionalities? And now, because how would it be different from the current methodologies in determining the patent term? Thank you.
Let's take, you can take note, Esteban. We'll take two more questions there and then the lady in front.
I'm Aram from C4D Lab in the University of Nairobi. I would like to pose a question to Maricela. There's Copyrights Board of Kenya, then there's KIPI, then there's IPMO Office of the University of Nairobi. If at all I register my intellectual property with them, is it international? Is it significant internationally? And am I going to be protected, or should I register it internationally? Yeah.
Thank you. We'll take one more for this round. The lady here, microphone, please. And then I'll invite the panelists to respond.
Thank you. My name is Nyakan Mwenyeki. I'm the chair of Innovation Kenya Society, a platform that brings all the innovators in Kenya to innovate across all the sectors. We are really keen to promote a culture of innovation, and we want to understand from the entire panel what you've all presented is very interesting. But looking at, picking from Padma Shri, evidence-based approach, how are you doing that and keeping up with the trends, especially looking at new technologies? You're looking at trends in different contexts, because when you're looking at the region, the trends are very different. And how is the WTO, you know, the TRIPS and all that, integrating these trends and consolidating IP laws and policies vis-a-vis the context and the trends?
Thank you. I'll start with Esteban. Please respond to the questions that resonate to you.
Thank you. About how I go about the formula, it's just a formula, and there could be many others. I just picked gross domestic product in order to analyze it, and there could be many other ways. What I did is first establish a direct proportionality, calculating first what will be the potential reward around the world. And it's basically the population and also it takes account the wealth of the world in one given year. And that wealth of the world in one given year is what could be potentially grabbed by the innovator. And so that's one first step. The second step is to distribute that proportionally according to the wealth of each country. So if I just did that, the poorest country will have what you see in the chart, but the richest country will have longer periods, and that will make the system not plausible because it will be 30 years, 40, 70 years for some countries. So what I did is calculate what the industry or the innovators will lose in the countries that will give less than 20 years. And then that I distributed among the richest countries, those that would give more than 20 years, also according to their wealth. So it's based on the wealth of each country. That's the way I have established this proportionality. And how to measure the wealth of a country? Well, gross domestic product is one measure. There are many others. As I said before, this formula I have talked about is only one or of many possible formulas to address the issue, but I did want to put one forth in order to generate a discussion, could lead to this trip plus ultra change. Thank you.
Thank you. Padmashri, do you have some comments to the questions raised?
Thank you for the question. Now, I mean, I think that we need to be clear about something. The TRIPS agreement is an agreement on protecting intellectual property rights, and it is based on the premise that those that innovate will have intellectual property rights. They have made investments which need to be protected through the grant of these intellectual property rights. The TRIPS does not take the responsibility of calibrating the needs to every country's particular context. It is the government of that country which has the responsibility to calibrate what is given in the TRIPS agreement to the technological needs, to technological forecasts within sectors, and to champion certain results through industrial policy. And this is where actually linking intellectual property to technology policy and industrial policy becomes extremely important. And I want to raise something which I think is very important that we never consider when we talk about innovation in least developed countries. Now, I've worked for, I mean, really most of my life, almost 18, 20 years in doing field surveys in least developed countries and developing countries on what really actually happens at the ground level. And at the ground level, firms do not have basic access to electricity, to water, to really port infrastructure, to road infrastructure. They do not have access even to simple technological input through public research. Industrial research in LDCs is stagnating. There is a growing R&D infrastructure and investment because of the African Union Summit, which calls for 1% of GDP in R&D, but you don't see that really translating to how firms innovate. Now, if you have greater R&D investment, it has to somehow trickle down to strengthening the capacity of firms to do research. Take the case of East Asian economies, take the case of China, now India. Public sector research plays a key role. Now, it doesn't matter in this reality, you know, if you identify new technologies or not. If now you have science, technology, innovation policy frameworks in a lot of LDCs which say we want to now identify priority sector, I will not name the country, space technologies, satellite technologies, nanotechnologies, but please, let's speak about making policy reality coherent. The reality is most of the firms are small and medium scale enterprises. They need to have a conducive environment to learn and compete and export and tap into existing trade opportunities. And this is not integrating into agro-processing in the global value chain. No, this is not what it is. What it is you need to value add. And it is only your national innovation system and your industrial policy that's going to help you to do this. And I think we need to bring that focus back always from saying the TRIPS is there and let's get a waiver. And just like Darlington said, let's get a waiver to escape from the TRIPS agreement. No, but how long are you going to escape? Let's get a waiver to see how we can actually, in the meanwhile, improve our capacity to benefit from what's going on.
Thank you. Yes. Please go ahead.
Okay, just to add Marisa. To what Esteban and Padmashri have said, I just wanted to say it's very interesting when you're talking about the empirical studies. And I think I had the opportunity of being involved in one of those when we were dealing with issues of copyright. And when we started off, the hypothesis was copyright is an impediment to access to knowledge. But I think as the studies went on, it was a whole team of, I think, 8 African countries, all developing countries, and LDCs. It was a mix of the two. And we found that the hypothesis had to change. It was how does the copyright environment affect access to knowledge? And this was, you know, many times we make conclusions without coming up with very specific studies. And it's amazing when you actually go to the ground and see, number one, what the impact of intellectual property is, and number two, what it is that we need to do to improve. And I think it's something that we should be encouraged to do. So I'll go to the question that was raised by Aaron. One of the things you need to know is that intellectual property is normally territorial. You know, so for instance, if you're granted a patent in Kenya, the grant is basically for that particular, for Kenya. Unless you're using, the PCT or whatever it is so that you can designate other countries to have your patent protected there. When it comes to copyright, I mean, that normally generally applies to industrial property, trademarks, utility models, industrial designs and all. When it comes to copyright, it's also territorial. But, you know, there are two principles under the TRIPS agreements that you need to remember. That's the most favored nation treatment and the national treatment. So whereby, like, for instance, if I protect my copyright in Kenya, automatically my work is going to be protected in Uganda by virtue of the fact that Uganda is a signatory to the TRIPS agreement. So that extension goes through. But more often than not, you'll find that any time, whether you're going to use the regional route or the international route, you have to designate the countries within which the industrial property is protected. Copyright, you need to remember, it's protected automatically. Registration is not a necessity. You don't need any formalities for you to enjoy it. But then when it comes to the national treatment and everything, you get to enjoy your protection in other countries which are part of the treaties that you're party to, and in this particular case, it's TRIPS. So I think one of the things, probably I didn't go into details when I was talking about the different pillars of the copyright system, and you're talking about issues of access to knowledge. When you're talking about management, you mentioned quite a number of institutions in Kenya. You find you have the government institutions. In Kenya, people get confused because you have the Kenya Industrial Property Institute and you have the Kenya Copyright Board. But you find that the Kenya Industrial Property Institute deals with industrial property except for plant varieties which are covered under KEFIS, which is a different government organization in agriculture. But you find that when you have these particular institutions, you actually have a focal point where the creative authors can have a point of reference. And there are certain issues that you can actually push forward in terms of, like, let's say, legislation. For instance, in Kenya, we've gone through quite a bit of amendments, and most of it is actually stakeholder-driven. And the focal point is the Copyright Office. So they do actually play an important role in ensuring proper management of intellectual property rights within the country.
Thank you very much. Another round of questions. The lady there, yes.
I just had I'm Chris Shragi from the University of Northern Iowa, and I was just wondering how can TRIPS or those types of agreements be integrated into working with, like, through the Madrid system to be able to handle things in a number of countries around the world, not just those who are part of TRIPS.
Thank you. The gentleman in front here, and then the one at the back.
My name is Andy Pasakala. Sorry, I came in a bit late. I wanted to know which country has the best IP laws that probably protects innovators in a way that you can suggest to a developing country like Kenya. I think there's no need of inventing the wheel. If there's a country that has great IP laws, the less developing country can borrow from them, and then we can see how things will be.
Thank you. The gentleman at the back, was there a question from the lady in red? Okay, you are next.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Edward Gwembo, a student at Kenya School of Law, with particular interest in intellectual property. And mine is more of a challenge that's directed to Daktari Marciela. And a lot has been talked about, but there's one thing that I've not really had been mentioned is about the young innovators and the youth, who I feel not many people are talking about, yet actually most of these ideas and innovations come from them. So what is the role of policy in terms, because you'll have good laws, yes, you'll amend them, they'll be up to date, but my question becomes, how do you now create an environment where the youth understand intellectual property? How can I be able to, you know, go ahead and file a patent? And how can I apply it in my business coming up, you know, as a young entrepreneur, as a young innovator? These are the questions or the challenge I'd like to pose to Daktari. Do we need more forum? Do we need to include the youth in such discussions? Because we cannot really keep talking about all this without considering everyone who is affected by such laws. Thank you.
Thank you, lady in red.
My question is to Padmashri. Very interesting work. Maybe I'd like to know a little bit more about what kind of indicators you have developed, and also whether you made any attempt to apply your kind of framework to any country with real life data to see where it is situated. That is one question. The other is, you were mentioning about the ground realities in LDCs, and at the same time the way you have looked at technology transfer very rightly, it's not about access, it's about absorptive capacity, capability building and all that. So, given that kind of ground realities, how do you see that kind of absorptive capacities and capability building in LDCs happening? What needs to be done there? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll allow the panelists to respond to the question, starting with Esteban.
Thank you. So I will address the first three questions really quick and with one theme, and it's that we should think globally, because let me make four points. One, we are talking about flexibilities. What more flexibility than to have a global standard distributed proportionally? That will be the greatest flexibility, and that will give access, that is an important issue, to the developing world, sooner than to the developed world. And that will make the developing world actually be able to create upon what is created by others somewhere else, because they will have access, free access to that technology quicker. The third point is that way we could all be part of the system, and that's an important issue for all countries to be part of the system. What we were talking about, that eventually the moratorium will stop and everybody has to be part of the system. So 3 plus ultra could make everybody part of the system. And fourth is that it is a plausible issue, because it's convenient for both sides, and that's the beauty of the proposal, I guess, in the sense that World Trade Organization works that way. It's convenience against convenience. And if this proposal is convenient for both the developing and the developed world, it has a possibility of coming through. And regarding the issue of which is the best way to address this issue for a given country, or what should the youth do about it, and I think that we should think globally. The youth today, connected and interconnected, and we are in a global society. We feel the global society more. So the best intellectual property law for any given country, for Kenya, for instance, is to go global and to go with this issue of with this proposal of 3 plus ultra that will let Kenya be part of the system and contribute in accordance to its capacity. And also, any Kenyan that innovates in some way will have the global reward for themselves elsewhere, not only in Kenya. Thank you.
Thank you. Marcela?
Okay. Thank you very much. Just to follow up on what Esteban has said, one of the things that I find very interesting, it's quite difficult to say which is the most ideal IP regime. But you see, you're not just looking at the law on its own. You could have the perfect laws. They're basically TRIPS compliant. They provide for everything that you want, but then you have a problem with the institutional framework, or you have a problem little or no enforcement of those rights. A good example is, for many countries, traffic laws. We have the traffic laws, but that does not stop people from flouting them left, right, and center. The main question being enforcement. If you go to Germany and you dare flout a traffic law, the consequences are quite dire. If you flout your traffic laws in the Congo or in Kenya or in Nigeria, chances are you'll be able to. So that's the reason why you find all that recklessness. So the same thing with the IP system. You might have very good IP laws, but the enforcement doesn't follow up. Or again, people have a very interesting attitude towards intellectual property. A good example is there's this music sensation who's basically hit the global scene, Adele, and has hit song Hello. A Kenyan artist did a fantastic translated cover version. And the first thing that the newspaper said is that there's no copyright infringement, you know, by virtue of the fact that it's in Swahili, it's not for commercial purposes. So you see, there's the general misunderstanding as to what intellectual property is all about. They have to remember that Adele, that is Adele's intellectual property right. She might have sold 25 million copies within a certain period of time. It doesn't mean that because I'm a Kenyan artist and, you know, I'm singing in Swahili, I can go ahead and do that without getting the authority. So there's also that understanding by the general public, the users, and everything as to what intellectual property entails. Then, again, when you look at it, as I said, you have to have the minimum standards that are offered by TRIPS. There's a reason why the WTO got into the whole intellectual property regime, because before it was basically dealt with under WIPO and everything, but they specifically looked at the trade-related aspects of it. So when you give those minimum standards, I think you're good to go in terms of the regime that you put in place. And the policy framework is very interesting, because you find that most of us do have the laws, but we do not have a specific policy. So our laws just kind of grew generically, is it, so to speak? Yeah, organically. And then involving the youth, I mean, there are very many dimensions under which we can actually get the youth to deal with copyright, for instance, or rather with intellectual property in general. In countries like South Korea, intellectual property is taught from, I think, age 7. It's something that you find in your curriculum. So people learn to respect. They know, you know, you have all these little cartoons we are being shown at the IP offices, which they use to try and get people to understand what IP is. So once it's something that is instilled in you, it's something that you grow with. So when it comes to innovation, you actually, the first thing you look into, it's your IP. It's not just a hobby. You're very good at mechanics. You know, you come up with very interesting ideas, you come up with all these things, but you're doing it for the Science Congress, you finish, and that goes on. Nobody thinks beyond the IP. So it's good to engage them at an early age. And all these innovative competitions and everything that they're involved in, we need to get in touch and get to deal with them. I mean, many countries are now trying to introduce IP within the high school curriculum so that people can understand. And it's something that you use as part and parcel of your growth and development.
Thank you very much. Sakin, and then Padmashri.
Thank you, Darlington. I think 2 points. One, what best IP policy for Kenya? And I think this really is a very interesting question. And what I just heard in terms of awareness about intellectual property. We need to realize the fact that, and I would just like to second the proposal that came from Padmashri, while dealing with the issues that are specific to a country's level of economic development. The intellectual property and its various instruments cannot be seen in isolation from the context. So each country has to see at what level of economic development they are in, and what is the level of engagement that they really want with such an instrument. And that's where I think the new approach that is required in WTO is to revisit the idea of special and differential treatment. Why do we think that a country would catch up in 5 years or 10 years, and we find that we have taken away the ladder that is required for the country to go in, if I borrow the phrase from Arjun Chang? So if you kick away the ladder, the country can never catch up. 5 years or 10 years or 15 years or go up to 20, 33 years, Padmashi said. So from that point of view, if Bangladesh is not able to catch up, there are several countries which would not be able to catch up. You need to realize what is the per capita income level. What is the income level in that country? Is it changing? And then, of course, the globalization has created its own islands of prosperity in each country. So south and the north that we have created, and north and the south. So that kind of inequality, the rising level of inequality, the few who have the access to some of these gadgets and access to some of the IP instruments, I think we should not focus, we should focus on the fundamental question of spatial and differential treatment that is required for not only intellectual property, but why do we need intellectual property? You need to consider that. You need to grow food, you need to grow crops, you need to grow the plants that are of importance. But if you find them that they are narrowly protected from the patents, from the copyrights, now you would find Monsanto and other companies, they are using patents and copyright both for protection in plant and life sciences. If that is the trend which is unfolding, what would our agriculture research institutions do in terms of developing new plant variety protection without using genetics? So if you do not use genetics and you want to develop your own plant variety protection, then you have several challenges in terms of moving forward. And this is not just agriculture. Pharmaceutical is the same story. My colleague, Dr. Ravi, is not here, but he has just published a paper in terms of showing how the combination of copyrights, which is for 60 years, and patents is going to create a major challenge for countries which coped up with generics. When the chemical-based drug development was happening, we could develop generics. India could develop generics, and we could supply it not only to Indian population, but to African countries, and also in Bangladesh, as Padmashree mentioned. But with biogenetics, the biosimilars are not the same. You would not have access to them. That's why it is important that we should have intellectual property which is commensurate with economic development. There is no best model. There is no best model. The best model is what our economic growth process is, what our targets are, and what trajectory we want to go on.
I have one question, and I'm just going to, what we did is that, you see, traditionally, the way we measure the impact of the ability of a country to engage in technological change is really R&D investment and patent data. And these are extremely inaccurate, actually. So what we try to do to develop these indicators is we try to look at indicators that are, that show actually learning and collaborative learning and capabilities at the, we broke them up into three big groups: knowledge-based capabilities, infrastructure-based capabilities, and institutional capabilities. And we looked at how everything at an individual level translates into something at a sectoral level and a national level. Let me give you an example. If you have more number of individuals who are successively enrolled in secondary and tertiary education, this translates into greater number of graduates and scientists available for a sector. And this translates into a bigger knowledge base of the country in the innovation system. If you have, for instance, more people who are coming back from abroad, so you have a greater link with your diaspora at the individual level, this translates at the sectoral level into greater availability of tacit know-how and financial investment, and that translates into greater capability at a national level. And if you have, for instance, more local patentees, that translates at the sectoral level into greater R&D investment into medium and high-tech technologies, and that translates into the ability of a country to tap into certain kinds of trade opportunities which are greater value added. So we broke them up into these different categories and tried to develop the indicators. Now, the This is basically, we haven't yet tested this, but what we have done is we have tried to find indicators for which data is available. Because LDCs are a large number of developing countries, you don't have data on a lot of things. So we tried to find indicators for which data is available that can help us to measure capabilities. Now, the other question you asked me is about technology transfer, how to make it work. You can't make technology transfer work by simply asking people to give you technology. And I have to say that I have a pretty strong opinion on that. I think the technology has to come and build your own existing capabilities. Take the case of South Korea, for instance. Okay, there was an agenda to build technology capabilities from the inside, and technology transfer was used strategically to bring it in. You know, and that's a very important thing. Any amount of technology transfer from the outside is not going to help you if you don't have the capability to break it down, use it, incrementally adapt, creatively use it, and produce something else. The same thing holds good for technology transfer. What you see is that you can make any amount of governmental commitments to transfer technology. Ultimately, it's the private sector that transfers technology. And the private sector needs something in return. It needs to have some kind of quid pro quo. And you need to develop your local enterprise sector to be able to offer that quid pro quo at least to some extent. And the government can subsidize that in some way, invest or do some other things to make it attractive, but you need the government to create the absorption capability. I have only one comment, and I'd like to ask our chair if I can ask that comment or share that comment. I mean, I'm very intrigued by Esteban's proposal. I think it's... But I have a problem with approaches that use neoclassical economics to study technological learning. And I think that in your model, although I can see from the graph that you're trying to measure welfare losses. And, you know, for me, this is a very difficult approach to swallow because countries change and there's a lot of stuff that happens in a dynamic way for a country. So, I mean, let me give you an example. Here, for instance, you have China, which went up from 7 to 13 years between 2005 and 2013. But India, which stays at 7 years from 2004 until 2013. Now, I don't think that this would be accurate if you would take, actually, the dynamic rents from all sorts of different factors that lead into building capabilities. Because it's not just about the size of a country. It's about, as Sachin mentioned, actually, the GDP per capita. It's about the kind of migration effects you're seeing from urban to rural. It's the kind of skills building. The country's own tertiary education or secondary investments, the country's own R&D investment, because that is going to change year by year. So if you're going to propose something which statically sets how many years a country is, very important thing is the growing size of the middle class, you see, because that is going to determine the demand. You're talking about giving 28 years in Germany with an aging population. Most of them, they are really having problems with sustaining the kind of demand that they have, but then other countries might not. And here in this list, India is figuring with Moldova, Mongolia, Cameroon. I mean, as an Indian who understands the dynamic knowledge capabilities of my country, I don't think I'm agreeable to this. And I think that it needs to figure in differently. I'm all for a kind of a differentiated regime, but I think it needs to be in a dynamic situational context.
Thank you. And probably have a review mechanism within that to take into account the fluidity. I will give an opportunity to, since I gave an opportunity to the lady, the last lady here, Maricela, is going to make the last comment from the panel. Esteban wants a response. I would want Maricela to address one important tool for development, and these are IP pools. Are these useful for advancing development in Africa and LDCs in particular?
I think it's very interesting. I'd start off with probably an anecdote about some time back we had some character in Kenya who wanted to fly a plane, to invent a plane. And he came up with very rudimentary things and everything, and of course it never took off. It had all those issues and everything. The question is, the jet engine, was invented and patented, I think, way back in the 40s or something like that. This is something that exists in, you know, like you can actually go and do a search and stuff like that. So most of the time you find that we don't actually take advantage of existing patents. And we can also use basically patent pools for development because you're looking at what already exists. So you're not going back to reinvent the wheel. It's interesting, a country like Uganda the other day came up with a motor vehicle. And I remember when I was asking my students, would you drive the Kira? And all of them looked at me like, are you out of your mind? You know, by virtue of the fact that, you know, these are guys, it's Makerere University, they've sat down, they've looked at what already exists and come up with a motor vehicle. It was done by, what are they called, the Japanese at one point in time. I think when I was growing up, driving a Japanese car was a no-no because practically everybody wanted a European car. Then as time went by, there are all these interesting cars that turned up, the Hyundai, the SsangYong Musso and everything, and everyone would be catch me dead in that. And right now, the Hyundai is one of the, you know, the best-selling motor vehicles. The question is, how are we utilizing the patent pools? Because they're there. Why are we reinventing the wheel? We have all these institutions that can do all this work. The interesting thing is that we don't talk to each other. So you find that the research and development is done by a particular part. They're totally oblivious of existing intellectual property, patents, and everything. So they come up with something, and it's a eureka moment for them, and you tell them that was registered in 1945 in the patent office in whatever it is. So basically it's not, you know. So we need to look at those, see what we can develop, how we can adopt those to come up with our own, you know, innovations. So we do not need to reinvent the wheel. And I think that's an area where intellectual property would work for most of the countries, especially the least developed countries.
Thank you. Thank you, Darlington, for giving me the chance to reply. And ladies go first, so it's good that I go after it. About the neoclassical approach or macroeconomic approach, I had a teacher, Louis Kronhauser from NYU. I talked to him about this proposal, and he told me that for him, he's a very renowned economist and also a lawyer, macroeconomics are kind of like magic, and he doesn't trust them. And what I'm proposing is to address those that do trust them. And what my model states is that those that address the issue in the neoclassical way and with a macroeconomic perspective, they should recognize that this system will produce less dead weight loss, according to that theory, or and that's good. It's in the sense that those arguments are also going to pile up with many others. One declaration is that Germany won't give 28 years, it will give 23 years, just three more years. And Germany do have an aging population that is going to suffer, but the government is wealthier than many other countries, and they'll have social security systems implemented that will allow them to get the blow. Instead, a country like ours, a developing country, do not have usually have implemented social security systems that are good for making their population access to the technology. So that's the two points I wanted to make. And the last point on enforcement, picking up on what Maricela said, I have theorized that there's also a sociological impact in intellectual property. And if the cartoons that she was referring to will say that people from a poor country will give less for the development of all humanity, they will be more willing to comply with the law because the law will be fairer. That cartoon will be more palatable to a person in Ecuador, to a person in Argentina, to a person in India than nowadays that same cartoon will be. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm laughing with Maricela here because she gave an example of a car in Uganda. President Moi here tried that idea too. It was called the Nyayo, I think. Yeah. So they tried the vehicle. In closing, I want to share with you one experience I had September this year. We were discussing regional integration. And one of the issues that came up in East Africa was that, you know, we were talking, how do you trade amongst yourselves if you are producing same goods? They all said, we are practically all producing coffee. So how do we trade amongst ourselves? And I said, you see, we have not utilized mechanisms of IP. Because as far as I'm concerned, with my experience, is that you can't have a product which is similar unless you are growing it on the same ground. And therefore, there's need to look at ideas under geographical indication. Because when you use geographical indication, coffee coming from Uganda is not the same as coffee coming from Kenya, and on that basis you can leverage and carve out your market. So these are avenues that we can use to enhance trade amongst ourselves and have a market for ourselves. That is development mechanisms of IP. On that note, I want to thank the panelists for coming out and sharing your knowledge and information. We are grateful. Shall we give them a round of applause? You saw from the program that we were supposed to have Pedro Roth from ICTSD as commentator on Skype, but you know, technology could not permit us to do that. May I also thank the participants for being so engaged and interested in this subject matter. You can clap for yourselves.